20 years ago to the day, I was a precocious, almost 16-year-old girl trying to decide where to go to college. A Minnesota girl sick of Midwestern winters, I was only sure I wanted to be somewhere else, somewhere specifically not the Midwest. But 12 acceptances from schools from Hawaii to New York left me paralyzed with indecision, and the decision deadline was coming whether I was ready or not. I went to college for all the same reasons people that age want to go to college. I wanted to explore new ideas and new versions of myself. I wanted to make new friends and maybe a few significant others. And I suppose learn some skills that might qualify me for employment after graduation. I specifically did not want to go to college to experience trauma or be exposed to violence. No one goes to college wanting traumatic experiences. But unfortunately for Black students attending predominantly white schools, including myself, the kind of schools, I might add, that make up the majority of colleges in the country, they're reporting exactly that. For us, trauma and violence in these predominantly white spaces are perpetual and unavoidable. The same racist incidents reported on campuses in the 1960s are being reported in 2021 because colleges and universities are currently racist. And time won't change that. At least it hasn't over the last 400 years. The arrival of the White Lion, the first ship transporting enslaved Africans to the Americas on the shores of colonial Virginia in 1619, accelerated but didn't start the construction of a racial caste system in what would become the United States of America. This system divided people into white and black and directly attached their social worth and their social power to their skin color. And it has persevered for 402 years. Less than 20 years later, in 1637, Harvard College, which would later become Harvard University, was founded. Students of African descent were obviously expressly forbidden at Harvard. Harvard, as well as the College of William and Mary, were the first universities to open in the US, and they were both explicitly for white men. A black man would not graduate from Harvard for more than 200 years in 1870. Black women would have to wait an additional 30 years, with the first black woman graduating in 1898 after the school's merger with Radcliffe College. And until the 1970s, Harvard admitted fewer than 12 black students each year. What I've just described is 350 years in which this university, all colleges and universities created in its image, were focused on two things exclusively. One, the needs and desires of white men attending college, and two, keeping black people out. That singular focus established institutional racism across higher education. Guaranteeing that black students at predominant schools experience trauma and are exposed to violence throughout their time in college. As a concept, institutional racism describes patterns of behavior and systems organizing social life within the institution that privileges white people via the policies and practices of the culture. Where racism is not simply individual, it is firmly embedded in how the institution operates, and whiteness is the default racial identity. Institutional racism has not diminished in higher education over time, and the complaints from black students on these predominantly white campuses are repeated decade after decade. For example, in 1969, members of the Black Students Association at Memphis State University protested marginalization from the predominantly white campus culture by infiltrating campus organizations from which they were previously shut out, like cheerleading, pep squad, and campus beauty competitions. The protest was meant to expose the racism, but also the isolation black students felt on campus, to highlight how damaging institutional racism was to their experiences. But very little has changed in the 50 years since. Black students, though more prevalent, continue reporting racist incidents on campus and describe a perpetual sense of non-belonging year after year. A 2019 survey of opportunity professionals, which can be understood as those folks with the words diversity, inclusion, or equity in their titles, answered questions about hate and bias incidents on their respective campuses. Their answers solidified the continued presence of institutional racism at colleges and universities across the country. Almost 68% of participants in this survey reported bias incidents in the last 24 months. Bias incidents like racist posters or pamphlets hung and passed around campus, nooses and Nazi symbols in 2019 purposely left in certain spaces, biased speakers allowed to come to campus, or racist bullying on social media or via email. 43% reported more than one of these incidents in the same 24-month time period. Hate speech and uncivil behavior was reported at 54% of institutions. 10% reported federal hate crimes. This data describes institutional racism in the aggregate. But let's zero in on exactly what Black students are experiencing on campus. In 2014, more than 60 Black Harvard students shared experiences of racism from faculty, administrators, and fellow students as part of the I2M Harvard Project by Kimiko Matsuda Lawrence. Participants took photos in spaces around campus holding whiteboards detailing racist incidents. The project was developed in response to a 2012 essay published in the university newspaper, The Harvard Crimson, by a white student entitled Affirmative Faction, in which they said, among other things, giving Black people entrance into schools like Harvard is the same as teaching a blind man to be a pilot. In 2019, Black students at Syracuse University administrative offices in protest of school administrators' handling of racism on campus. These students wanted administrators to understand their culpability for these incidents, and therefore their culpability for Black students' general sense of as a result of continued inaction in response to increasing racism on campus. In response, administrators refused them food, opting to starve them out rather than support their needs. Black faculty, too, are penalized via institutional racism at predominantly white schools. In the summer of 2020, tens of thousands of Black faculty detailed their own experiences of racism on their respective campuses via Twitter, capturing a critical mass of institutional racism via the hashtag #BlackInTheIvory. As a Black woman faculty at a predominantly white school who used to be a Black girl attending a predominantly white school, both Black students and faculty grievances echo my own experiences since the day I made the decision to go to college 20 years ago. Institutional racism is not just cultural, though, as well. Recent allegations of funding disparities at the most racially diverse schools in the University of California system spark questions of racial equity and highlight how structures inflict trauma as well. The continued prevalence of institutional racism on college campuses disproves the old adage that time heals all wounds. In fact, time does not heal all. It doesn't change molecules or shift ideologies. Don't shift, and institutions aren't restructured purely as a function of time passing. This is messaging from those with the power, but not the willingness to create change. It's messaging that obfuscates responsibility for establishing and maintaining the kind of social changes that lead to equality. Because racism is endemic to American society, so too is it endemic to American colleges and universities. A commonplace condition in society, like sickle cell anemia, is endemic to the Mediterranean. A unique American racism festers like a disease inherited perpetually over time, stagnating in our communities despite interventions. It's a constant threat. People dying out over time will not precipitate the end of racism any more than moving from the Mediterranean will eliminate the threat of sickle cell anemia to your children or your children's children. So what can be done? healing a racist society requires the same deliberate and repetitive care as any other tangible wound. Time may not cause healing in and of itself, but it does provide the opportunity for healing. If colleges and universities want to eliminate institutional racism on their campuses, administrators must first acknowledge that this may be a 100-year project and will require prioritizing the needs of Black students first time. There are no quick fixes, no federal or state policies or cluster hires or programming initiatives that will magically remake these schools in an anti-racist image. Instead, commitment, recognition, are required for reimagining racist institutions. First, an institutional commitment to a long-term focus on anti-racism, maybe 100 years long, must be made by shifting power that's long been siloed among white male administrators to a more diffuse sharing of power among Black and brown underrepresented folks who will lead strategic planning towards institutional change. This is the first, most important, and obviously the most difficult task to accomplish because it asks white men in positions of power to act against their own self-interests in exchange for the improved life chances of others, something which at present few are volunteering to do. If accomplished, the shift in power and the commitment to anti-racism it suggests acts as a foundation for the other two requirements for reimagining racist institutions, recognition and proaction. Recognition of the institution's long participation in American slavery and American racism. From the enslaved Black people who likely helped build the original buildings, to the Black students and faculty asked by Camp ID to prove they belong there. Public acknowledgement and contrition of the institution's role in perpetuating racism is necessary to heal the pain it's caused. And proaction, long-term strategic planning towards an anti-racist institution not centered on recent racist incidents on campus, but rooted in structural and cultural changes as necessary by the required recognition I just discussed. Now, I don't mean to make light of the deep roots of institutional racism by reducing institutional change to three simple words. A shift towards anti-racism will be hard. It will and restarts as the new power brokers try to get it right. It could take 100 years or it could be longer. Who knows? What we do know is that 400 years of time hasn't brought about anti-racism at American colleges and universities so far. Time provides opportunity, but true change only happens if we want.